Hello, and thanks for watching Proactive New York. I'm joined by Greg Wong. He's the CEO of RIWI Corporation. Greg, very good to meet you.
Nice to meet you, Stephen. Thank you for having me today.
You're welcome. So, Greg, for those viewers not familiar with the company, can you tell us more about RIWI?
Sure. So RIWI, we are a prediction and trend tracking company. We invented a technology several years back called random domain intercept technology. It's a patented technology. And what it enables us to do is intercept web traffic and then provide people with surveys based on whatever country they're in. And what our research shows and what our data shows is that we're able to reach people in hard to reach places. We've done surveys about 2 billion different responses in 229 different countries in over 35 languages. So lots of data collection all around the world, and especially in hard to reach places.
Who are your typical customers, Greg? Are you looking at the government sector, the private sector, or a mix of both?
So it's really a mix of both, but we focus on three specific customer segments to date. The first one is international development, where we've got customers like USAID, World Food Program, Chemonix, and many other large development organizations, NGOs, really organizations that are looking to help make the world a better place. We then have financial service customers, where we've got customers like Bank of America and others that are leveraging us to collect data, really in some cases for trading purposes, in other cases for macroeconomic analysis. And then we've got healthcare and health systems and public health, which is where we've done a lot of work around helping track things like COVID and long COVID or other types of pandemic monitoring for organizations, again, around the world.
I mean, can they measure the benefit that it comes from using your services, Greg?
Yeah, so it really depends on the customer segment, right? If you think about financial services, for example, they can leverage us for trading purposes. So are they making good trading decisions? Are they getting information, for example, on consumer confidence or inflation before the official numbers come out? Are we doing some very specific stock management on called big consumer brands like Netflix or some of the electric vehicle type demand? So the financial services customers can definitely measure us. When you look at a lot of the international development and aid organizations, it's really about the impact they have on people around the world. So, you know, if people are migrating, if people are, let's say in Ukraine, you know, where were people migrating, for example? Us being on the field, on the ground, being able to capture that data real time was able to help them figure out where do they need to bring aid, support, water, food to support people, you know, that are migrating and in need. So absolutely they can track the benefit. Sometimes it's a direct result. Sometimes we are part of a much larger program.
How are you, Greg? So, I mean, I noticed that you made an acquisition back in July. That was of a company called Research on Mobile. That brings in a new revenue stream for the company. Are you focused on acquisitive growth, organic growth, or again, a mixture of both?
We're really a hybrid. We're really looking to do both. So today we've got this great, again, RDIT technology we use to do surveys. What ROM does is they dynamically and automatically match survey participants with survey marketplaces. So if you think about kind of an integrated process, we're sort of at the customer end and they're sort of one step back. And so what they end up doing for us is provide us a much more integrated solution from getting survey respondents and making them available to our customers as well as other survey customers. So we intend to continue to grow organically and invest in different customers, building products for our customers, but then also through acquisition and looking for always complementary acquisitions. Any acquisition has to fill a couple of categories, right? It has to add technology to us to increase our platform. It has to increase our customers base. And ideally, it's also going to give us more synergies where we can upsell and cross-sell products across different customers. So we're really looking for those different attributes. And, you know, of course, we look for attractive multiples. And, you know, the environment today, while it's really tough for us as a public company on our stock price, it also makes it a little bit easier in some cases on acquisitions because everyone else's multiples have been brought down as well.
What would you say sets you apart from your competitors in this space, Greg?
Yeah, so, you know, there's a lot of people that do some basic surveys for organizations. What we really do differently today is we do global. So we do a lot of ongoing long or global hitting customers around the world, like in China, for example. But then we do a lot of time series type data. So we'll do ongoing surveys that go on for 12, 18 months, 2 years, 3 years. So people can look at data and analyze it over time. What are trends? What's changing? The other thing is our same technology is used today to do two other use cases. One of them is message testing, and the other one is more some campaign management. And the best example I can give is we did a project last year for an organization that was really trying to understand the impact of COVID and how to convince people to get vaccinated. And so we did a first survey, you know, all around the US to understand, you know, why were people not getting vaccinated. Then we went into the message testing phase where we again put out a survey to a lot of people, but based on who they were, we put on different messages so we could figure out why they were not getting vaccinated. And you know, if you were a white older Republican male, you had a different reason for either getting or not getting vaccinated than if you were a younger female Hispanic person, for example, different. So we were able to do a whole bunch of message testing to understand, you know, why people were not getting vaccinated. And then we went to the third phase, which is, again, we intercepted all this web traffic and then started putting the right types of videos and messages in front of people to help them get tested. And so, you know, where a lot of people will do data collection, we do a much more fully integrated process and support multiple use cases.
I mean, let's look at your revenue model, Greg, because I presume you get you build annual recurring revenue through these contracts.
Yeah, so historically, we were a more of a project-based revenue organization. So we would get hired to do a project. It might be a one-month project or a six-month project, and we would go and deliver that project, and it would be really almost consulting revenue is how I would phrase it. Over the last year, we said we made a decision, a strategic decision, to switch from project-based revenue to more a subscription-type revenue. So now we are doing much more subscription-based, where we're selling people access to our platform, we're selling people access to long-term data streams. And so we now are having recurring subscription revenue. We still have project-based revenue for organizations that want just a project. But you know, you mentioned ROM as an acquisition. Since we acquired ROM, ROM also has a new revenue stream called transaction revenue, where they make a call a transaction fee on every survey respondent they match to a survey marketplace. And so now we have three different revenue streams: project-based revenue, which is called the one-time revenue; subscription on the platform-based revenue, which is ongoing and recurring; and then transaction revenue, which is, you know, not exactly a transaction fee like a credit card, but very similar, and it becomes very repeatable as well.
But I realize you're in a closed period at the moment, ahead of the release of your second quarter results shortly. But give us a broad outlook for the company and for the growth in your business.
Yeah, so we've been going through a broad transformation. As we talked about, going from project-based to recurring revenue meant we had to do a lot of things, right? We had to look at our customer base and really prioritize who are our most important customers. What type of technology and solutions and what type of data streams do these type of customers need? So we've been going through a broad transformation, and I think we announced this about 6 or 9 months ago, but we said as we go through this process, you know, we're going to be a little bit bumpy for the next 12 to 18 months. So, you know, what I tell everyone is we are making success in changing our business model. But from a financial perspective, we will be bumpy for the next 6 to 9 months, which also means we're probably a great time to invest. Because, you know, if you want to invest in an organization where they're killing everything, you're going to pay a significant premium. You're able to invest in us right now at a lower multiple, you know, before we complete this transformation, when our multiple will then probably go up.
Well, Greg, I hope you'll keep us posted on any developments and progress. Thank you very much for the introduction today.
No problem. Stephen, thank you so much for having us. And if there's ever anything else, you know, feel free to reach out.
Good. Thank you. That's Greg Wong. He's the CEO of RIWI.